Fight Club is, you do not talk about Fight Club. The second rule of Fight Club is, you do not talk about Fight Club.
I have nothing but respect for these competitors. Make no mistake, I am cocky in prediction. I am confident in preparation, but I am always humble in victory or defeat. Some people will sit and take positivity from that. They will look at that and take inspiration and inspire. It will inspire them to go and push for that. Others will shell up and critique and be negative towards it. One thing is sure, those people will stay where they are. The people who take inspiration from it will rise.
Then make no mistake, I'm setting up to be the greatest of all time. I am working towards it, and I will go down as the greatest of all time.
Bam! Been chopping trees. I done something new for this fight. I done wrestled with an alligator. I done tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail. That's bad.
Thanks for coming, guys. Welcome. Yes, they can hear us. Cool. All right. So again, thanks to everybody that participated. I know I want to say this real quick. Like, I don't want it to get like to turn into like a freaking battle of everybody. Like, it, the whole point of this is like, if you participate, you're a winner. You know, like, in my eyes, I think in everybody's eyes. Yep. So good job, man, for trying. Even if you were scared. Because I got a lot of messages from people like, I don't know if I should do it. Like, I don't know if I'm ready. Like, I might jump in later. And it's like, just go for it, man. You know, just like Shia LaBeouf says, just do it. And so congrats to everybody, you know, good job. And Alex, thanks to you, man, again for, you know, judging. And
anytime, man, and thanks for having me.
Yeah, dude.
Everyone, again, for entering in this. And I hope you guys like will consider that I'm just a person with some personal preferences. Some of my picks might surprise some people. Some might confirm your suspicions of who should win. But in the end, like Ricky said, you're all winners for entering in this. And it's never about the prize. It's about being in this together and having fun.
Yes.
So. Should we start with the mention?
Yeah, well, actually, I'm just gonna go through the entries real quick, just to kind of give a shout out to people. I got my Facebook open, so shout out to Laura Bavon. Sorry if I butcher your name, guys. I'm sorry. This was an awesome piece. I loved it. Real quick, loved it. Scroll through them, and then I'll go through them, and then you go over your top favorites, and then we'll do the final four. Does that work?
Yeah, sure.
All right, Jeremy Gordon, loved it. Loved this piece. I think some underlighting would have worked really good on this one. But anyway, we're not gonna crit everybody because that's Adam did a gauntlet piece. I'm not even gonna try to pronounce your last name, dude. And I can't read that, but this was a really cool entry as well. Good job, Nicholas Rivero. Good job, guys, and I hope you guys saved the entries without the draw or die logo or anything of that, so you can use it for your portfolio and stuff. By the way, this is important because we have people like Manuel that got featured in Imagine Effects from one of his Ascension pieces. So that's why you want to make sure you can, you know, remove the text. I think Nell for Card got picked up for Spectrum from one of her Ascension pieces as well. So make sure you guys don't merge all your layers with the freaking words and all that. Just a FYI. Who's this? Andres. I'll say it in Spanish. Andres Gomez. Good job, man. Nice piece. Jack Hoyle. I really like this piece too. It's really cool. I like the cigarette with a panda. Eric Summers. Really cool piece. Joel Turina. Very warm piece. Joseph Guy Yung Hao. Good job, man. I like how you pushed it. You went more for a scene. Liked it. Edgy Cyan. Oh, that was a really nice piece too. Love the line art for that. Really stylish. Raphael TL. Oh, Raphael. Good job, man. He's kind of an okay guy too. No, I'm kidding. He's always in the hangouts. By the way, guys, if you guys see the hangout threads also as well, like that's a really good place to go and hang out with people and learn and stuff. So just a plug. Stacy Turner, good job. She went back to a guy. Good job. Marshall Oles, really cool piece. Dynamic. Stephen Howard, good job, man. Gunner Larson. I like this one. This one's cool. I like how he added the newspaper to that. He's got like a little, like he's like a middle finger. That's cool. Who's this? Andres de Leon. I'm reading that in Spanish. Leighton Buxman. Good job, Leighton. She came out of nowhere. She said she was going to do it. She jumped in. Good job, Leighton. Justin Adams, love this piece. Really cool piece too. Really cool piece. Neltsu Narcissus, good job. Sorry De Burgo. I'm sorry. Sorry. You teach me later how to say your name. I'm sorry. It's Alex's fault. I'll just blame it on Alex. It's his fault. Morgan Melville. She's always in the hangouts too. Good job, Morgan. I got to see her work a lot on this piece. Good job. I love how you, and then she added the girl on there too. So it's pretty cool. It's kind of funny how like you're showing her dying, which is kind of where we might be going. Gregor Velerger. I'm sorry, dude. Cool piece, dude. I like how you use the logo for it. Like it looks legit. Like it looks like you put a lot of work into that. Ian Shreve, good job, man. It kind of looks like Connor from the group Irish Connor. I don't know if you're watching this, Connor. Kind of looks like you. Cedric Cave, I really like this piece too. Really cool. A lot of things going on. Ninel Mayakova. It's very, it's got a little bit of samurai taste to it. Kevin McDowell. Kevin, good job, man. I like the sci-fi in his sci-fi. You went sci-fi and fantasy with it. Adrian Alejo. Cool piece. I like this one. This one just, yeah, I like it. Rodrigo Vincent's Perfect. We're just gonna call you Rodrigo. That's a long ass last name, dude. I really like this piece too a lot. I thought it was really cool. It's got like a Mayan taste to it. So cool twist, man. I like it. And my girlfriend Dan Llanos. You go, girl. This piece, I was telling him his style reminds me of, I don't know if you know who Travis Charest, I can't pronounce the last name, but he reminds me of that guy. Really amazing line art, man. Like, I don't know if you got to see his works and progresses and like all the work he put into this. Like, he did so many designs on it. Like, it's just mind blowing, man. It's so good. So good. Cheater. You're too good, man. Stop it. Brian Ewan. I like how you made the panda really tiny. I kind of wanted to do that too. And Rude De Jong. I really love this piece, like how different it is, and it's got like that Adventure Time. Like, I've always been like, as soon as I saw this guy's work, I was like, oh, it's so different, you know, it's original. So I liked it a lot. I've always been a fan of his stuff. Esther Berry. she kind of did. I think actually she followed your Gumroad, dude. She was using a lot of your Gumroad ambient occlusion stuff.
I thought I saw something like that in that piece, but I wasn't sure.
Yeah, she. I think she definitely was. I think in her. I think in her thread, she showed some of. I think she was talking about your DVD, your tutorial. So really cool. It's cool. I think that's like, that'd be cool if like we all like try to do like emulate the judges style, but it would kind of suck in the game because then like everybody's different. So, but it's kind of cool that she did that. Ian Barker, I love this piece so much. I love it. Like, I love the colors for this one, and I love that the panda is like a robot. I don't know, what was that noise? Are you there?
I don't know. I'm here.
That was weird.
I don't know. I heard it too.
Yeah. Ghost. Who's this? Pier? Is it Pier? Albacar Rhoda. Very clean entry. And Kelvin Liu or Lau? Is it Liu or Lau? I've known him for a while and I can't pronounce your last name. Sorry, Kelvin. I love you, man. I like this one. I like the storytelling for this one. Like, you got the statue and a guy. Just with holding the sword, like, what the fuck? I like the storytelling on that. Franz E. Swam. Cool piece, man. Thanks for jumping in. Simon Mandel. I love this piece. I love it. I love how simple it is. Like, I love it. I like it a lot. I like it so much. He's got a broom showing that he's like, he used to be a janitor. Sergio Palomino. Cool piece, loved it. I like the thread too that you were doing, dude. I think I put some of this in the video too. I'm making a video, Alex. I don't know if you saw it. It's pretty funny.
I haven't.
Yeah, it's pretty stupid. It's like a trailer, and it's retarded. I'll show you later. Alec Van Ostrom. I think this is traditional. Good job. She said she learned lots. Kyla Junkis. Or Junkis. I said Junkis. Ooh, I love this piece too. Really cool. I think you're going to pop the characters with a light. With some light coming from below. Like, you probably could have popped this piece and made it. Like, I love this piece. But I think they're a little bit too dark in the front. Maybe some light coming from like below them to pop them up. But yeah, really cool piece. Taylor Christensen. Dynamic. Loved it. Good job, man. Vinicius Bortoletto. Love this piece, man. I like how fat the panda is. He's just like a big. He reminds me of my dog Mojo. He's just fucking overweight. Matthew Cowdery. I love this piece, man. Piece. Yeah, I love this piece. This piece is phenomenal. Loved it. Like, the level of detail and rendering and then the background. Really good stuff, man. Good shit. Ryan Mahan. Cool piece. He's got, it's kind of like, it reminds me of like a movie poster almost, or like a book cover.
Yeah, book cover.
Yeah. Jen Walden. It's Jen. I'm kidding. Jen's awesome. Good job, Jen. I like how the panda's sleeping. Oh. And Paris, you know. Jesus Christ. Paris, good job, man. I like the big sword. Jen A. Talking in the chat. I got the chat open. Caravan Black. Good job, Caravan. I like the little armor on the panda. Like, he's got like a faceplate. Carrie Bean. Good job. Jeffrey Robbins. It's like the after battle. It's a lot of entries, man.
tough choice.
Luke Maddox. Good job, man. Like, there's so much going on in this fucking piece. Like, Jesus Christ, dude, like, you went balls to the wall on this one. Like, it's just, you got a whole fucking army and fucking like a mech like thing, and it's ridiculous, dude. Good job, man. The only thing I gotta say about this piece is the hair. Like, it, I don't like his hair, but that's just me. That's just my personal. But other than that, man, the colors, the detail, I love it so much. Good job, man. Alex Danila.
I think it's Danila.
Yeah.
Might be Romanian.
Is it? It might be.
Sounds like a Romanian name to me.
Are you Romanian, Alex?
Yes, half gypsy.
Somebody said hater. I think that's Luke. I'm not hating, dude. I love it. Mo Bellinger. I love this one too. This was a really good one. Brozel Henry. I like the colors for this one. Patrick Bjorstorm. This one is awesome, but you went with a red panda, and like we specifically said, don't do a red panda. It'll still go in the book, but you know, just keep in mind that we wanted it like an actual panda, not a red panda. I was reading the fucking Cosmo Gligor. Nice piece, man. I could have gone for a little bit more light on this one, but good job, dude. Like maybe some fire, like some sort of torch to light the scene or something. Mal Koalas. Cool line art, dude. Nice. Reinhardt Sanchez. Good job, man. Kubok Jr. I think. Looks like a 3D model, actually. I didn't even see it. Yeah.
Were they allowed to use?
Yeah, they could do 3D as long as it's not a pre-made. Pre-made. So I don't know if this looks pre-made. I'm not sure. I hope not. I hope you didn't use like. I don't know what you 3D people use, like a pre-made model, like a stock. I don't know how that. We'll have to talk to him. Sebastian Orozco, cool piece. I like how you went like fucking Rambo with the panda. It's cool. Sterling Morris, love it. I like how the panda's just like, he looks like a pirate, but he's just like, oh, and he's got a cupcake. Rim Gustainis. I never pronounce. He's always
Rim
in.
Gustainis.
Yeah.
Maybe the Greek person.
He might be. I forgot where he's from. Rim, where are you from? He's always in the hangouts too. Derp is best. I like it. I like this piece, man. It's so cool. So cool. Luth. Good job, Lou. Sal V. Cloak. Sal's always in the hangouts too. Good job, Sal. Well, for the Firestarter Prodigy. Ted Highlander. We'll just call you Highlander. Ted, good job, Ted. And I was telling you about that fucking font, dude. It looks so... That was just me telling him in the hangout. I was like, dude, get rid of the fucking font. Like, make it simple. So, yeah, just keep that in mind. I like the piece, but that font is so distracting, dude. That's just my personal... And that is it. That's it for the entries.
Yeah,
good job.
It. Like, a lot of entries. Really impressive ones. Oh, man. People are gonna hate me. No. Some of them.
No.
So.
Good job, guys.
Again, congrats and good job. Thanks for entering. I really appreciate taking your time to do this. And I hope you had fun. So, without any further ado.
Yep, we have a belt for this, and I made a panda belt for the. Go ahead, we'll start with number four. The honorable mention.
Number four. The mention spot. It's Are we gonna ring the panda bell or?
No, panda bell. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So it's Matthew Calderi. Oh, I wish we had some sounds like.
Kind of like a mute, like a little song.
Yeah, like when people are on
like
the radio.
Like a crowd cheering or something.
Yeah. Okay. Congrats, Matthew. So I really like this piece. Like the rendering is super tight on it. Why I haven't placed it, and again, it's my personal opinion. Another judge might have placed you in the top three, but to me, the story didn't work. Like the angle you choose, it makes the character not feel so strong. He doesn't feel like a character that's about to achieve something, like, or. Maybe if you went with this angle, you could have shown like a shadow of the monster that he's about to fight or something, right? So you can see that's in the shadow and he's about to jump at someone, right? But at the moment, that you would have placed in top three, definitely. And yeah, it's just the angle. It doesn't work with the story that I think you're trying to express in your illustration. But congrats.
Yep, good job, man. I loved it. Good piece, man. He's already working on his second one, too. It looks pretty fucking awesome. And he's sticking to the crazy calendar schedule that we have for the group, which I should be getting on here after we get done with the hangout. So, good job, man.
Yeah, great job.
Oh, shit. Number three. I went to number three.
Okay.
Are you ready for number three?
The Jong or the Young?
Yeah.
Congrats.
Number three.
Well, I really appreciate like stylized characters. I don't mind like this style at all, and I think this is a really well done piece. Even though it might look simple, it's super hard to do something simple that looks good. And yeah, combining it with Adventure Time and the two guys holding that broom, it's like, I really like how they are holding it. So yeah, the design, everything, colors. Yeah, this is what made me decide to put this on number three.
Yep.
So congrats.
I loved how original it was, man. It's like, I've never seen this style. It's got that Adventure Time, like.
Yeah, but it has this unique spin on it.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty cool.
Good job, man. Loved it. I'm not too sure about that. I gotta say, I'm not too sure about the. It kind of looks weird down here, like sword. Like maybe if you just like type it out. I'm just saying, if you just typed it out, it would make it look a lot cleaner. Because right now it's kind of like fucking with your rock down here. So
yeah, it's not really clear the text.
Yeah.
And stuff, but. Yeah, that's like not a big problem.
Not at all. So, yeah. On to number two.
Number two is Luke Maddox.
I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna do that. So now we got it.
This is what I meant.
Now we got it. Number two is Luke. Good job, Luke.
So, for example, this image portrays exactly what you're supposed to feel. I mean, the angle supports the story, and it's fucking badass, man. Like, all the time you spent on this, it really works. Sometimes, like, it's good to explore a lot of angles and stuff, but you definitely chose the right one for this one, and it really feels like a celebration. Like, these guys made it. This is kind of the end of the story, where they are able to relax after the fight or whatever. I really like the panda with his number one. He's really funny.
Just cheering him on.
So yeah, really, really awesome stuff.
Yeah, good job, man. Good job. I love it. I love it. Like I said, the only thing I kind of had a beef with was the hair. But that's just me. I think it looks too clean. Like it looks like he's about to go to the office or something. But other than that, Loved it. Yeah, great piece.
Great job.
And
number one.
Number one.
is Dan Janos or Janos.
Dan, together.
You win!
In composition, in colors, in line art, in stylization, style, or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, it's fucking badass. It's like a final book cover.
Yeah, man.
It works.
This is next level shit.
Yeah, and there's a lot of hidden detail in the piece. I really like that. Yeah, like, it's almost a perfect piece to me.
I just realized you even drew the fucking the wizard, dude. Marilyn the wizard. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Holy shit. Oh man, yeah, dude. Guys, definitely, like, if you're watching this, like, definitely be inspired by these guys. Like, don't think of it as like, oh, fuck Dan, you know. Like, even though I think fuck Dan sometimes, no, like, you should be inspired by it, you know. Like,
oh man, yeah, dude.
Oh shit,
guys,
echo. But yeah, definitely get inspired by it and try to. The thing, I think, I can't remember who said this quote, but it's a known quote, was that you shouldn't, I think it was Dan Levizi was talking about how he's not competing against other artists, like, he's in competition with himself. Like, your next piece should be a better piece and a better piece. Like, you shouldn't worry about, like, what level somebody else is at. Like, do better next time. That's all that matters. Like, as long as you're doing better, that's good for you. Like, don't worry about being the best right now. Like, no, there's no such thing as being the best. That's the point. So stay motivated, man. Keep going.
Also, I want to shout out some names that and some artworks that I really liked, and I put everything in a folder and I started like deleting one by one and like trying to narrow it down. So the following people were in the final cut, and it was really tough to. Choose. So Laura Bevon, Alexander Lucas, Justin Adams, Esther Ebere, Simone Mandel, Jan Barker, Kyla Jonkas, Vinicius Bortoletto, Alex Danilo, Sterling Morris, and probably there are even others, but I kind of separated these people from the rest to pick up the winners and stuff. Yeah, it was really, really hard. And I'm sorry, like, that some of it didn't get picked or whatever, but it's so hard. And one day probably you're gonna go through this and you'll see how hard it is.
Yep. Yeah, man, I wouldn't wish to judge. There was too many fucking pieces, man. It was hard.
You can write me
hate mails. Yeah. Nah, man, I think that's why the group isn't at, you know, 60, 70,000 people, is because we cut the assholes out and we keep the good people in. And so it's a bunch of good people that I think they all push themselves. So I think they'll look at this and learn. So good job, guys. Good job. Thank you. And thanks, Alex, again. I'll go ahead and mention the next brief. Yeah, I'll probably ask you next year if you don't mind. Hopefully we'll have a website by then and a book out, and I'll let you know when this book comes out, and then if you have any personal pieces that we can put in there. But I'll get a hold of you whenever. Thanks again, man. And guys, so you know, the next challenge is this challenge was a guy which is pretty much Sword and Stone, that's what the story's called, Sword. And the next character is Snow White, pretty much, but with a little bit of twist to it. And that's a guy's girlfriend, and they gotta go save her now or whatever. But the next judge is Betty Yang. So the brief is out, and probably tomorrow I'll update the banner and then put the brief in there. But everybody already has the brief. And then I'll put the file in the files tab. So yeah, good job, guys, and thank you, and hopefully
congrats again to everyone that has entered, and a special congrats to the winners.
Good job, guys.
So yeah,
yep. And what else did I have? Oh yeah, for people watching this is all gonna be it's gonna get published. We're gonna kickstart it. We're gonna put all the entries together at the end of the year, and then we're gonna we're gonna kickstart it. If we can't kickstart it, I'll approach some publishers. But I think we're gonna more than easily be able to kickstart it. The stipulation is you have to participate in 9 out of the 12 challenges. So this was the first challenge, and we're gonna have 11 more. So keep jumping in, even though you know your piece isn't the best or whatever. Just jump in, and we're gonna publish everybody. Like, we're gonna try to publish everybody. So right now we have already 60 pieces. I can't guarantee that they're all gonna get like big spreads or whatever, but they're all gonna be in the book. So that's why we're all in the same size. So make sure you read the brief and get the same sizes, because there was people that were kind of mixing it around with a size. So make sure you follow the brief. Other than that, thanks guys, and next month will
have
be
a great
fun
day, guys.
Yeah, have a good day. And Alex, again, thanks man, thanks for judging and everything, dude. We'll see you guys. Thanks for coming.
Bye.
Later guys. So yeah, let's get started. Guys, welcome. Since this is going on YouTube, I'll do a little intro real quick. This is an interview for Draw or Die. We're a Facebook group, art group, and we do monthly challenges, which are called Ascensions. And right now we're at Ascension, is it 29? Yeah, 29. I'm horrible with numbers. Ascension 29. And for every challenge, we have a guest judge come in and look at everybody's pieces and pick their top 4, which is first, second, third, and the honorable mention. Last month we had Dan Lavizi for January, and for this month we have Alex Negrea. So it's really cool. If you guys haven't heard of the group, go check it out. It's a lot of fun, and we're making a book. So Alex will be the first official judge to be a part of the group, the book that we were just talking about and stuff. So it'll be a lot of fun. I'll take all the blame for it if it fails. We're trying to change the game a little bit, trying to make some new things happen in the art world with this book, which is to publish everybody, as many people as we can, you know. So that's kind of like the incentive to, because right now when you're in the when you're in a struggle, and I'm gonna ask Alex about that, and I'm more than sure he knows about this, going through the struggle without payoff and just busting your ass and killing yourself at art and drawing 24/7, and still nobody knows you, nobody knows about you, and it could be depressing. And that's kind of what the book is about. The book is to put your name out there, even though you're not there yet, like to have something you're proud of and feel like you're doing something and people are noticing what you're doing. So that's what the book is about. So I'm hoping we can change the game a little bit with that and kind of show the new wave, which Alex is, we were talking about this as well. Alex is a part of the last, what I call the last wave. And I'll hit on that later. We talked about it earlier, but yeah, so that's what the book is about. That's what Draw or Die is about. And now we're doing the interview with our judge Alex. So welcome guys. Welcome, Alex. Thanks for
judge
doing this.
Sounds so funny.
I know you're the judge.
You need a hammer.
Yeah,
you need one of those real judges.
You need a hammer, man. Well, we used to call it an AD, you know, but now we just call them judges. We're like, yeah, it's just a judge. We'll just go with judge.
Yeah.
But welcome, man. Thanks for doing this, dude.
Thanks for inviting me. It's an honor to be here, it's my pleasure to be a part of this, and I will do it anytime.
Sweet dude, it's good to have you, man. Like I know I've been following your work for like shit for like 3-4 years, I think, and I gotta say, dude, you're one of those guys.
I feel like I'm getting old now.
You're one of those dudes though, man, that like that just keeps pushing. Like I remember seeing like all your like 1,000 hands, 1,000 faces. I'm like, shit, dude, like you're killing everybody, and it's so awesome to have you here, man. Like you're one of those guys that doesn't stop, so it's pretty cool to have you here, and I'm humbled. So yeah, guys, thanks for coming too as well, and let's get the interview started. We'll start with like the typical, like, how did it all start for you? How old were you when you started, and et cetera? Like, did your parents...
I don't remember exactly what age I had when I started, but it was in 2009, and now I'm 27 years old. I'm going to be 28 in a few months, so you do the math. But it was right after high school. I studied mathematics and informatics in high school, and then I went to college for the same thing, and I did 1 year of that thing. And my girlfriend did the math. It's 7 years ago. So yeah, after a year of that thing, I realized that is not what I want. So I tried to switch careers, and drawing was something that I was kind of attracted to. I didn't know people that draw or anything, but fortunately I was in the right place in the right time, because all the internet community kind of exploded in that time. So I had a lot of inspiration on the internet, and it kind of gave me the courage to pursue my dream and become an artist. It was either this, either drawing or being a guitarist. I was usually I picked up guitar in high school.
Nice.
And I was playing it like I used to draw back in the day, like for 6 to 8 hours a day I was playing the guitar. That wasn't that much actually, because I still had to go to school, but when I picked up drawing, I was drawing all day long, because I don't know, when I have a passion, I invest all my time in it, and yeah, it's really enjoyable for me. And actually, I don't even know if I like drawing. It's more, I like learning new stuff, and I like to keep my brain busy with something that allows me to do something new. I don't know. I'm gonna be honest, sometimes I get bored of drawing. So recently I started picking up 3D, and that kind of refreshed my whole perspective on art, and I started picking up photography, and that's again something new that allows me to kind of connect these domains and do something new, and it's super exciting, and I kind of recommend to everyone, if you're kind of stuck with your current progress as an artist, if you're only drawing, just go for
something 3D.
Like that's a tangent with your passion.
Ooh.
So yeah.
So you're more of a.
Well, that's the question, because I feel like I'm talking about.
No, well, I guess I'll ask. You're more of a learner. I think, yeah. I kind of know that feeling, but at the same time, I do love art. But yeah, I think if there's not a challenge, you kind of get bored with it.
Yeah, I like to have challenges. Of course, they are kind of daunting in the beginning. Whenever I start a new image, I feel like scared of it. And that fear never got away, no matter how many studies I did and stuff. But the studies and all the stuff that you, all the work that you put into them, it lowers that fear. And the more you study, you kind of build up momentum, and then you can pump up better images and better, and eventually you're going to be more confident, but that fear, to be honest, never got, never left me.
Never goes away.
Yeah, even today I have, literally today, but these days, sometimes I avoid starting a drawing because I fear that I don't know how to do it. But it's just nonsense in my head, once I start it, I can think differently, the more you just think about it and you're not doing it, the harder it is. But even if you start and you do mistakes, and that's the key, do a lot of mistakes, your brain is trained to recognize mistakes. And when you see those mistakes, your brain tries to fix them, or it tries to tell you, okay, try to fix this area of the drawing. And you're going to be lazy in the beginning. And it's a constant fight between your brain that wants to change stuff and your laziness that doesn't really want to, oh, it's good enough, and oh man, I lost my train of thought again.
You're just like me, dude. Yeah, you just squirreled. It's fine, but it makes sense though. It does make sense. So we were hitting on the. You said you started in 2009, and then
yes.
and then you said because the community and stuff like that. But before that, you really didn't take art seriously. You said it was more.
Well, I had drawing classes once a week. They were regular, normal school drawing class, not art classes. You had 1 hour per week to do. It's just called like that drawing. That's the name of the class. So they would tell you, okay, now for 2 weeks we're gonna draw a tree, and that would be the final work. And they didn't even care if it looks good or bad. If you had some color inside, and if you would color inside the lines, you would be like a top grade student. So my drawing career didn't start back then. I like to draw, but I only did it at school and rarely at home. Actually, I remember that when I was super young, and the Pokemon craze was going on, I drew all the Pokemon, but I didn't draw them from imagination or different poses. I just like copied all the 151 Pokemon, and I traded them for a Game Boy for a friend. That's the only thing that I did like that could have been something like more art related.
That was like your first.
I didn't really.
That was your first job.
Yeah, my first job.
Okay, so you started, I guess, a little bit later with the serious grind, and you said you the art communities that were there at the time. So I guess.
Well, I drew for a year, and like when I decided, okay, I'm gonna follow this design college, I drew for a year without being serious about it, and then I got to be more part of the online community, and I saw people that are literally like machines when it comes to studying, and that's when I realized, oh my god, this is how you do it. And yeah, for a year I was in dark, and like I drew like stupid things. I was trying to be fast, I was trying to use brushes. Like if I would see my first inspiration was Andrew Jones, and you know, he had those videos with the triangle brushes and portraits, and yeah, I wasn't trying to understand anatomy, I was trying to understand the brushes and stuff. It's like, it's the typical beginner pitfalls, you know?
Yeah.
How many RAM do you have? What brushes do you use? Yeah, so I've been through that.
Yeah, everybody, I think everybody goes through the crazy lost artist. So for that whole year, you were just trying to figure stuff out. And then, and I'm guessing you ran into an online community. Was that I don't think you were. Did you catch the conceptart.org days, or was
no,
it?
So
it was the Crimson Daggers.
Was kind of dying when I started.
Okay, so it was the Crimson Daggers that you found.
Yeah.
Them. Okay.
Yeah, a friend of mine told me about Crimson Daggers. He's a 3D artist now, and we were both like kind of. He was more advanced. He was modeling stuff, he already had a portfolio, and we started talking. He's also Romanian, and right now he works for Guerrilla. Anyway, the point is that he told me, we kind of meet up on this Romanian forum, there's a visual art community forum, and he's been trying to draw, and I was a bit better at drawing than him, so I told him, hey, do you want to meet? We were living in the same town, so. And he was more of a part of the online community, and he knew about Crimson Daggers, and he told me about it. But when I heard about it, I'm like, that's bullshit, like I don't want to go in any community, what fuck this cult. But after one point I decided, okay, I'm gonna try it, because I was like kind of stuck, like I wasn't doing anything special, so I said, okay, let's see how's it going. And yeah, that's how I found out about Crimson Daggers.
And the rest is history.
Yep.
So, okay, I guess we'll talk about that, the Crimson Daggers, and because it's part of the legacy of, like, I think everybody, man. It's really, for me, I look at it as waves. Like, you had the initial conceptart.org wave, and then you had the wave that came from...
Yeah, I think before Concept Art, it was Sidrun Forum. Where Craig Mullins used to post,
yeah,
with his buddies.
Yeah.
Then, from what I know, concept art. Then it was Crimson Daggers.
Yep.
And then I think Level Up.
Yep. So, well.
Yeah, it's kind of like that.
Yep. And now that's what I want to do.
With,
and now.
So, I don't know if Patreon is a thing, actually.
What is it?
Sorry?
What was it?
I don't know if Patreon is actually.
Oh, like, Patreon?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it seems like the next thing, and it's not like a forum, really, but it's something like you can get into an artist's head and support him so they can do better art. So it's kind of nice. I mean, you can get resourceful insight from artists that you admire, and you can really support them to create stuff. So that's nice, and I think this is the next thing, actually.
Yep, so it's fun to look at the development of the art communities and stuff like that, because it's kind of like history in the making and stuff like that. So the one person I could say, I don't know if you've ever heard of Manuel Castañón, like he's one of the guys that kind of sprung out of Draw or Die, and right now he kind of reminds me of you, like his work ethic and stuff. He's just phenomenal, and
there's so many new artists that literally kick my ass, like, and they're so young, and like, it's times have changed, like, and now you have more tools and people have changed their mentality about art. I mean, right now it depends what you want to do as an artist. Do you want to have a professional job, or you want to be a fine artist, or do you just want to draw for yourself? This is kind of how I divide the whole drawing thing right now. And yeah, like, if you want to be a professional artist, now you have to use all those tools that appeared in the past 5-10 years, I don't know, like 3D, photo bashing, and I don't know, matte painting, everything that's included. Like, there are people that literally just started like last month, and in a month they can do something great with the help of these things, and the industry is going to go towards that point, because of course the clients will want that. And then there's people that train to be super awesome painters, mm-hmm. that focus on the traditional way of doing it. There's still going to be jobs like that. I don't think they're going to ever disappear. And I think that's nice. And then, yeah, there are like people that just want to do their stuff. They don't want to be necessarily a fine artist or whatever. It's kind of my category. I kind of like to know everything. I like to learn new things, and I don't want to fall into... I don't really like production art, like where you're forced to do, I don't know, 10 thumbnails every day and then render one of them and whatever. I think it's a bit of bullshit. I'm more of a, like, I just want to paint whatever the fuck I want to paint today.
That sounds good. That sounds good. So, yeah, and I guess to hit on that is what I tell people my biggest thing, and that's why we're not allowing shortcuts for these challenges for the books, not to mention because I don't want to get sued, but... we're not letting people photo bash, and that's because we want to push people to do it the long way instead of doing the easy. I mean, I guess it's a little controversial to say it's easy, but it kind of is easier. I'll say it. I have an argument if you want to talk about it. I think it is easier. I think anybody that knows what
to get to there faster.
Yeah. And, because I think, like, right now the industry is going into this, like, cookie cutter, like, this is what art is. And it's like, no, dude, what's going to happen when everybody can photo bash? Like, people are going to want to see people, you know, you draw and stuff. So I don't want to go away from the...
Yeah, it's a nice feeling to know that you can do it without any tools or whatever, just with a pencil and a piece of paper. Mm-hmm. Or any mark-making object on a piece of paper.
Exactly.
But yeah, it's... I don't even know what I'm thinking actually about this subject. It's... We can talk for days about it.
Yeah, pretty much.
And clients want what clients want.
Exactly.
They want it fast, and like, and if you're not gonna adapt, then you're gonna suffer. The people that get over this ideal of trying to understand everything, they will be ahead of you because they don't give a fuck about the thing. And I don't know, it's not bad what you're doing. You're just trying to create art faster, but sometimes it's nice to take a step back and really analyze what you're doing, not be like not counting on those happy accidents every fucking time, you know? Because yeah, like I've mentioned, people that pick up a software and in 1 month they do something that I couldn't do in 2 years or whatever, but those people are also limited. You have to, I don't believe in talent, but there are people that are more sensitive to proportions, or they see like things differently.
Yeah.
And those will, only those, and I think they're less than 1% from the average Joe, you know, that they will be able to pick up something and then become like quite decent at it in a short time. So still, like, if you want to learn something good, it's a good idea to study, like, to take the long road. Stop trying to imagine that there's a magic brush or a magic software or whatever. It's like, yeah, go study those things, but also put the accent on the foundations. I think the foundations can take you much more further than any other software.
Definitely. Definitely. So, all right, we'll go back to your Crimson Daggers days, and for me, I guess I'll mention it, which is why Draw or Die started. I missed that too. I didn't jump until towards the end, and that's when everything was kind of dying down, so it sucked. And then that's why Draw or Die started. But for you, like seeing like the challenges and stuff like that, it obviously motivated you, and I'm willing to bet that it made you a better artist to find out how people were getting better. So what did you do, like, what were your studies, and what did you do to get better as an artist at that time? Like, what was your goal?
Well, that was the first, I only realized what studies can do. Like, I saw that people were doing studies, and I did them for a long time, but I didn't realize why and how to do studies. Until the first blood sports, I think it was Swamp Elder. And for that challenge, they mentioned, okay, it's mandatory to do studies. And I said, okay, I'm going to do studies because this is the challenge. But in my mind, I was like, okay, I need to change something about this whole studying thing because, okay, I will do like 10 naked girls, but I have to draw like a creepy wooden creature. What's those 10 girls will help me like doing those studies, what will give me for the wooden character? Like, they have nothing in common, maybe the pose or something. But so I try to target my studies on my needs, like, and I started writing down, okay, I want in this image flowers, trees, I want branches, I want swamp. So, and then I collected some images from the internet. I don't really stick to just images. Sometimes I watch videos, I make a print screen, and I create like a mood board, or I don't know how to call it, like a reference board, whatever.
Yeah.
So I put there all my images, and then I start breaking it down, and I start studying. I focus either on the lighting or on the shape of the leaves or on how does tree bark looks like. And I try to figure out ways how to paint that with brushes. Maybe you can paint them with the default brush, but sometimes you can, like for the clouds, I think everyone knows like how to make a cloud brush or whatever. And
yeah.
So yeah, you try to figure out those things, and it's like a big puzzle. But if you connect all those things, you're going to be so much closer to what you wanted it to be in the beginning. And like with the puzzle, there's no way to cheat. It's like you have to take one piece at a time and put it together. And it's the same with those studies. Like, there's no way like you just do one study and then your painting is going to look amazing. You have to figure out every problem in your painting and then break it down and acknowledge it, solve it, and then put it back as a piece, like a solved piece, you know. You just clicked two puzzle pieces together when you solved something. And slowly you do that, and eventually you're gonna realize that there are some patterns in good images, I guess. I don't think my images were amazing or anything, but they were far way better than the ones that I did before those. And it's just that mentality. I changed my mentality. I changed the way I was looking at things, and I tried to write down stuff and put it together. Even how, like, writing things down has helped me tremendously. You just realize so much better when you're writing something down, because you made like a mental note. You can't write something down if you didn't notice it. So once you write it down, you're 100% sure that you saw that piece of information. Like, I don't know, the reflection gets a bit distorted in the water of the tree or whatever. You write that down, and when you're gonna be in that area of the illustration and you're gonna paint that, you're gonna remember, I noticed in that reference that the reflection in the water, because there's wind on the surface of the water, or maybe the fish like swim in the water, there's a tiny distortion in the surface of the water, and that creates distortion also in the image that I see projected on the surface of the water. And then you realize that the water is like a sinuous function. I don't know if I'm using the right word, but that is like a wave. And basically now you're gonna see like the faces that are front are facing you from the sinuous wave are gonna reflect things that are behind you or above you, like the sky or whatever, and that's gonna create a, a breakup in the silhouette of the tree or whatever. So see, you can get so deep with like small studies and small observations, and that's what made a difference in that point of my career. Like I finally realized how to study and how to be smart about it, because just studying, just painting every day something won't make. Am I still here?
Yes.
Because you're super quiet.
Yes.
Okay.
So it's about studying smartly and not just doing things to do things.
Yeah,
that makes perfect sense. To be honest, I've been stuck on that dump study stuff, but it makes perfect sense.
One of Kim Jong-un's books is like, there's a quote from Abraham Lincoln, and he said like, if I have 10 hours to cut down a tree, I will spend 4 hours just sharpening my axe, and then like, see, like it's a different way of thinking. Like you can try to cut down that tree with that dull axe, but if it's not sharp enough, you're not gonna cut it. Like probably you're gonna need to invest twice the amount of time, right? But if you sharpen your brain, in this case, I mean, if you're sharpening your axe, and this is a metaphor for the brain, you're gonna be so much more efficient, and you're gonna be there in like faster.
That's a nice quote. That's a good quote. I like that. Good shit. Yeah. Good shit. So you learned how to study. You were thinking. You weren't just brainlessly doing studies and stuff like that. And then
yes, that was how Crimson Daggers worked before. It was just about the studies until they introduced the challenges. I think, if I remember right, I'm old.
See, I didn't know that. It was just studies, and then they started doing.
You would submit your studies, I think, and they would create it or something like that in the beginning before the challenges.
Oh wow!
I don't even remember. It's so long ago. Probably there's a place online where we can go. I don't even know if there was a forum.
I'll look for it. But I know a lot of good stuff came out of that group, man. It was I've seen a lot of it. I've gone back to look at a lot of it just to kind of get some guidance on where we're going and stuff like that. So after during this time, you weren't getting any work, but or were you getting work when you were building up?
I don't remember.
You don't remember. So
I know my first job was a freelance job for a girl on DeviantArt, and she didn't pay me the entire amount, and it was this fat chick. She wanted me to paint her with her two boyfriends fighting for her and another older guy behind her watching over them as they fight.
What?
Yeah, that was my first official job. And then I had a few freelance jobs, and then I got an email from Gameloft. I think I was working for Gameloft when I started doing when the blood sports were on.
So you were already working professionally then?
Yeah, but I just started, and I don't really know why I was hired, to be honest, because my stuff wasn't good enough, I think. Okay. Probably they needed someone, because like in Romania, there are not a lot of artists. And there's Gameloft, and I think they needed someone, but by my standard, like I wouldn't have hired me right now.
You
would have
hired
my work back then.
You would have hired yourself.
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
if there are people in the chat that are stressed out that they don't have jobs, it's about luck too. Like I don't know. Like I consider myself like hardworking, but sometimes it's just luck. You never know what you're gonna do today, and it's gonna affect the rest of your life. You know. I think I got hired because I entered in a contest and I drew some planes. The theme of it was speed, and I drew some like a flying plane thingy. And I think that's how someone from Gameloft noticed me. So yeah, just entering all the challenges, just draw, like, don't stress out about jobs. Jobs will come to you. Just post every day or almost every day and work your ass off. And eventually, jobs will come to you.
Yeah, because that's a big thing in the, like, the people starting up, you know, I guess mentality is that they get frustrated, like, oh, am I getting any jobs? And,
yeah, but it was the same for me. I was stressed out too, like, people only see the good parts of your life, usually. They don't see the struggle that you've been through and how much you worked for it. And they just imagine, like, oh, you're so talented. And, like, you were there in the right time. You were right there when Crimson Daggers was. And they only see the benefits. Like, but now you have the same opportunities, but they're disguised in something else. And it's all about you, like, getting jobs and stuff. And yeah, people overthink, and I used to overthink too, but just do it, and just draw, like, enjoy.
Just do it.
Yeah, it's been said, like, so many times, and yeah, you only need to draw something that you enjoy, because you only want to draw something that you enjoy, otherwise, just stop drawing. Don't draw because you want money.
Yep.
That won't probably happen. It can happen, but it's, again, you're talking about those probably 1% in the artist community where they don't enjoy what they're drawing, but they're making a lot of money and they still do it. And they only care about the money. But if you're like me, you care about what you draw, and you only want to draw something that you like.
Yeah.
And I had so many times where I quit jobs because I didn't like what I was drawing. I quit AppleBot because I didn't like what I was drawing. Even though the AppleBot images got me a lot of, I don't know, fame or whatever on the internet, but I wasn't really happy, and I left before they imploded. Like, there was a time where they just fired everyone, and I left before that. Like, people might think I got fired, but no, like, I stopped caring about it, and I wanted something new, and yeah, it was a good time for me in the beginning, because they were paying good, but if you're like me, no amount of money is going to satisfy you.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really care. Like, I just need enough money to survive.
Exactly.
I'm not saying that I don't like when I have money either. I like to have money, but usually with a lot of money comes a lot of slacking. The more money I have, the more useless things I buy, and it feels like you're in this fucking cage. And when I say cage, I mean your room. And you just start piling up books, toys, and games, and guitars, and whatever. And literally, you feel like you're choking. That's what it felt like to me. I had a lot of money, and I was spending on shit that I didn't even need. Just and that useless. Shit is distracting because the more things you have, the more distractions you have. And instead exactly. of drawing, you're just focusing on stupid shit. And then you're left behind. The industry moves forward and you become this piece of shit that can't draw anymore or can't keep up with the new wave. And I don't know, it's just like a fight, you know. You just need to be always aware and with your guard up. When you let it down, you're gonna get punched in the face and probably left behind.
That's a good reference. That is a good reference. And we were just talking about that, the money thing, and we were talking about publishers for the book and stuff that you were looking at. And I like that. Like, I respect that you were like, oh, you know, like, I'm not going to talk about like the specifics that we talked about, but you were like, you know, I don't care about the money. And that's a good thing. I think that's a good sign of, for me, the elitist me, I guess, is of a true artist. You know, we're doing this for the art, not so much the money.
We're not even doing it for the art. We're doing it for ourselves. We humans are selfish creatures.
That's like, true.
You don't do anything for anyone. You just do everything for yourself. And the happier you make yourself, the better it's going to be.
That makes sense.
But yeah. Money won't make you happy. I guarantee that.
Yep. That makes sense, dude. So, okay, we'll kind of backpedal a little bit because we talked about how you were... See, I didn't know that. I didn't know you were already kind of doing work before Crimson Daggers and stuff. So before that then, I guess before you were in Crimson Daggers, you were already doing some work. So like, then I guess I want to talk about the grind, the studying, like how much, because this is like the question that people always ask and stuff. Like how much were you drawing? How much were you working and all that stuff before you got your job?
I don't know, I'm a really jealous guy, and when I see good artists and great artists, and when they post stuff, I get really angry on myself that I'm not like them. So that kind of hate for like, made me like, okay, I have to try to become better than this guy or whatever. So I told you, it's selfish. Like you want something, I don't even know why I wanted that. Now I don't care anymore. There are so many great artists, but I'm over it. It's like, okay, I got my piece to it. But in the beginning, I really thought that there is the one artist that's above all. So my goal was to find that artist and become better than him.
So who is that?
Of course.
Who is that for you? Who is that for you?
Back then, it was Hannes.
Hannes.
Yeah, Augenflicker.
I gotta look him up. I don't know who that is.
For me, it was the top artist because he was like doing studies like they were fucking photoreal. At least for that time for me, when I was looking at his images, they were photoreal, and he kind of opened my eyes like, okay, people can do this and there's a way to do it kind of faster than in a traditional way. Because I like speed also, doing something super fast. I really like it's like I'm talking about the dark side of the Force now, you know?
Yeah.
I'm more of a Sith, not a Jedi, you know? I'm talking now about taking time and do your fundamentals and stuff, but in my heart, I'm a Sith. I just care about speed. So I saw him that he was doing this digitally, and I said, okay, traditionally it's much slower, so I'm going to try to become like him. And I was looking at him, what he was doing, and I was like, doing... Yeah, I think that's how I got my first job, because I was trying to copy him and I was doing studies, a lot of studies, like mindlessly, because he was doing studies, he was targeting them from the beginning, I think. That's why I think he evolved so much in such a short time. But I didn't realize that, and I was trying, like, if I saw him doing a car study, I would do a car study, because that's what clicked in my mind. Okay, I have to do what this guy is doing, but this kind of mentality, It's kind of bad, because of course you're not gonna evolve in the way that you want to evolve, because we're all fucking different. We're yeah. not the same, and I'm sure Hannes likes some things and I like some other things, and probably you see it right now. We started with kind of the same tools. I kind of copied his techniques, but I evolved in a different direction than him. He kind of got away from photoreal stuff, and now he's doing more stylized stuff. And I don't know how to describe my style because I don't even know if I have a style. Because this is how I draw right now, and I can't see myself as I see other artists. For example, when I see a painting from Dave, I know it's Dave. He has some things that give it away that is Dave. So probably I have those things too, but I don't know them because I do it, you know. What was the question again?
It was we were talking about the inspirations. But do you think it helped you though to have that one inspiration to shoot for? Like, do you think you'd be as good if
it's good in the beginning? But I bought a book a while ago, and it's called Still Like an Artist or something like that.
Uh-huh. I've heard of it.
I'm not even sure. Like, it's a book with the cover is black, and Still Like an Artist, I think it's written with white.
Yeah.
That's all I can give you. But the guy was talking about the creative mind, how it works and stuff like this, and he was giving a few tips that were making sense, and they still make sense at the moment. It's like when you're stealing someone's stuff, like even if you're getting inspired by someone, you're trying to steal his knowledge, right? If you're stealing from one person, then you're going to become a bad copy of that person because you don't really understand that person.
Yep. Like,
100% how he thinks. But if you steal from 10 or 20 persons that you really admire, then you're gonna kind of fill the glass but with all this kind of different information, and that will allow you to develop in your own way. You're only picking up, it's like when you go to the supermarket and you look at a bunch of bananas, of course you choose only what you like. You don't try to take the whole the whole thing with you, right? Even though you like bananas.
Yep.
You only take what you like, and then you go to a different supermarket and you get the other bananas that you like. I don't know. It's a stupid, like...
metaphor.
Yeah, but you get what I mean. Like, you only take what you like from an artist, and then you move forward. You don't need to copy 100% that artist. That's why you get a lot of copycats.
Clones. Like,
bad cats.
Yep.
There are people that only like the Blizzard stuff and they draw that fucking orc the same way over and over again, and they don't have their spin on it. And of course, like, the Blizzard guys won't hire you because you draw exactly like their artist. Like, why they would hire you if you draw exactly the same? Probably if their main guy would die, then they would consider you, but till then, they don't care about you. Like, the more you become someone else, the less chances of getting jobs you might have with time. Because yeah, that's true. You being able to paint in a certain style can give you some jobs, like doing cards art. I'm not talking about the Magic the Gathering. That's so much high quality, I think, than other card games. But there are now some card games where it's this sexy chick. She shows her cleavage, and there are a lot of people that can do this, but I was to this workshop and everyone had the same card, but drew like slightly similar, and it doesn't stand out anymore. They don't have any design. It's just that chick thing with a bunch of flying blue and purple around it, suggesting that it's magic, and that's it. And yeah, it's just focus on the artists that you really like, and try to learn. Try to see what are their mistakes, analyze it, and don't do them yourself. Because I'm sure when you look at my artworks, you can see some things that are off that I can't see. Don't try to copy, like, if you really like my work, don't try to copy my work 100%. Just copy the things you like, or, I don't know, be inspired by the things you like, and then go to the next artist and try to see, like, okay, maybe this is a different way where he thinks. And, like, I'm sorry, it's like, I feel like I'm going in circles.
No, it makes,
I got the point across.
It makes sense. And I mean, it's like right where I'm at, because I was like, I still love Dan Levesey's work. And for the longest time, you know, I was trying to be like Dan. And
it's
now
I have to interview him. Like, I know it's like so hard to talk with your inspiration.
Yeah.
I only talked to Hannes once, and I felt pretty uncomfortable because it was an inspiration to me, and like I didn't know what to ask him because I didn't want to make him upset. So, with my inspirations, I never talk. It's like I don't. They're. It's like they're not even there anymore for me. I just keep them in my mind, and also like sometimes I had inspirations, and when I started talking with them, I realized that I don't like them, or there is something that bothers me. Like maybe they do a weird thing. Maybe they're assholes. Maybe they punch people or kill cats. I don't know, you know. And that doesn't allow me to like them anymore. And in my head, that whole like iconic image of my idol is ruined.
It kills it. It kills. Yeah. Yeah. No, I gotta say though, Dan's. I'm lucky enough that Dan was, when I first started, was really nice. Even now, he just judged the challenge, the last challenge. So he's a very humble guy. So luckily, you know, like I don't have that to worry about. But I get what you're saying. Though.
I've met him once, and yeah, he was super nice with me, and he's one stand up guy.
But back to what you were saying, though, was that you got to take from different things. And if you just want to be one person, then it's not going to happen. And I think recently I just figured that out. I'm like, wait a minute. Like, there's so many other artists that I love and that I'm looking at. Yeah, and it's like, why just Dan? And don't get me wrong, I love the shit out of Dan stuff. But I'm like, you know what? I'm going to start doing other stuff and things, and that's kind of where I'm at right now. I'm in that like lost, like I wanted to be like this person, but now I'm realizing that I'm not that person, so I have to do my own thing. And so what's my own thing? And so it makes perfect sense to what you're saying is, and that's pretty cool that you mentioned that, because the thing about a lot of professionals right now is they kind of forget that feeling, like what they went through. A lot of them were just like, I just did this or that. But that's that feeling that a lot of us are going through, that are trying to find their style or trying to find whatever it is that they forget. And so it's really cool that you mentioned that.
I don't know. The main thing is that you need to enjoy it. If you're not enjoying it, you're not going to do a good job. And that's it. There's no further magical explanation to anything. If you enjoy what you're doing, if you like drawing the orc from World of Warcraft like 1 million times, the same way, just do it. Like, I'm not here to tell you stop doing that. If that makes you happy, that's perfect. Because that's the whole thing. Like, we have a limited time on Earth, and there's no point into like being frustrated and depressed because you can do what you want to do.
Yeah. Yep. And that's I guess that's, at the end of the day, it's like what makes you happy and what you want to do with your life. And that's I think kind of big for me, because I don't think I'm cut out for freelance. I kind of like doing my own thing. I guess because I'm kind of retarded, but yeah, I guess it's what you love doing, and just do it is what I tell people. But at the end of the day, though, still, whether you're just doing the same thing or whatever it is, the only way to get better is you have to draw your ass off. Like, you just have to. Like, there's no other way. Like you were saying, there's no other way to do. So you didn't answer that question. Like, how much were you drawing at that time? Like, when you were starting out, like, cause I want to hear it.
That was a tricky thing, because I was thinking that I was drawing for 12 hours, but recently, like half a year ago, before I went back in studio, I had a 2 months or so of like just grinding, and I would only start my timer if I would be drawing. So I try to draw every day for 8 hours, no matter what. And I realized that, okay, I was drawing for 8 hours, but the day was over. And of course, like, I was waking up at, let's say, 8, and I was going back to bed at 12. There are more than 8 hours in between that time.
Yeah.
But I realized that probably I wasn't focusing for 12 hours. So if you really want to see how much you're drawing during a day, just start a timer and only let it go if you're drawing. If you're not drawing, just stop it. and you're gonna see how much you slack, and it's gonna be depressing. But also, at the end of the day, when you see it, you only have one more hour to draw or stuff like that, and you are all warmed up, and you're able to pump up those like drawings like it's nothing. Man, that's the best feeling. There's nothing that compares to that. It feels like you have, I don't know, your biggest idol, let's say. Sounds gay, but let's say that Hannes is moving my hand and I'm drawing like him. But yeah, like something like that, you know.
So you were...
It feels like you're not thinking anymore. It's just your hand draws, and you become one with the pencil and with the artwork. Wow.
So you're shooting for 8 hours. Is what you're saying, and the reason why I'm bringing this up is because you have a lot of people, and like I'm kind of like, because I'm not at your level yet. I'm still like down here where you remember, and I can see like the differences. I can see the differences in like the people that are studying and stuff like that, and what I'm looking at, and a lot of people like will have people recently that they'll post like, yeah, I've been drawing for, you know, for 8 months and I'm not getting better. And it's like, yeah, you
only adds to the stress, to be honest. And the more you think about it, just put that timer on and just draw for 8 hours every day.
Well, the question is, that's the thing, is the question is like, how long are you drawing per day? Like drawing 30 minutes a day or 20 minutes a day? Like
I was still drawing a lot. I was a lot of sketchbooks. So not sketchbooks. I had just like, they weren't sketchbooks. They were like just, notebooks, like regular notebooks, but without the cross-hatching. Like they were like math, I don't know how to call them in English, sorry, but they were just regular
notebooks. Books, notebooks,
yeah. And I would draw in them, and I would draw over and over something that I would understand, and I still wouldn't understand it because I was stubborn and I was approaching it the wrong way, like trying to analyze. And like, I think Vilpu was in his videos mentions like, do not copy what you're seeing, analyze. And yeah, like I did copy a lot of stuff till I realized that, oh, this is what he means to analyze. Try to find patterns in the drawings. Pay attention to angles, values, edges, all that stuff. And just like, every mental note that you make, everything that you write down, it's going to be one step closer to be there forever in your mind. Sometimes you have to repeat something. Like right now, probably if you make me draw someone in armor, I wouldn't remember, I wouldn't remember even 10% of the armors that I've studied. But if I would go and just look over those studies and just read what I wrote, it all comes back to me, like, oh yeah, I remember writing that down. I remember noticing that. And yeah, then you in your mind, it will be like you're going to the supermarket and you have a checklist. Okay, now I want a helmet. I want it to look like this. But I also want to combine it with that other helmet that I studied that had, I don't know, some broomstick on, like a Mohawk broomstick thingy. And yeah, you start combining stuff and you come up with new things. And I don't know, have you seen that thing called Everything is a Remix?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So yeah, everything is a remix in the end. Like,
that makes sense, dude.
We're just supposed to improve what our ancestors built.
Exactly.
Like, take it in ourselves and chew it and then spit something else out, you know?
Very true, dude. Very true. That's kind of what I tell people. It's like, we just have to get better and better, and push it. But, okay. So we talked about your, I guess, study, getting better days. And then, you getting jobs, and, now I'm guessing though, you were, because obviously I don't think a lot of people knew who Alex was. I didn't know who Alex Negrea was until I jumped online and I started looking at the stuff that was going on. And then I saw, like I said, I jumped late into the Crimson Daggers thing, and had heard that you won. So that's kind of like what you, that's kind of where you kind of came from, sort of like where people started knowing you from. So you said you've been lucky. So in your eyes, you weren't really trying to get popular. It just happened because you were participating and stuff.
Well, I was doing all the shenanigans that I could do.
To get noticed.
I wasn't over trying to become popular, but I kind of realized that this is like also a popularity thing. And the more I get my name out there, the more people they're going to know and the bigger chances to get a job I will have. And that's why I was posting most of the days. I was trying to enter in all these challenges and I was trying to make my name out there, and to put it out there.
So, yeah.
Like, I wasn't doing anything special. I just tried to get published in books. I think I only got published in one or two, but still, like, who knows? Probably someone that gave me a job saw me in that book, you know, or whatever.
So just keeping your name out there is kind of
key. Yeah, it's essential. Like, otherwise, there are so many people that pick up drawing now. It's like so much easier to become an artist these days than it was before. I mean, I'm considered one of those lucky sons of bitches that had like all the fucking advantages in the world. But right now, I think it's even easier. Like, you know, when you're talking with people that work for the industry for like 20 years, they said they had no internet, they had no groups or Crimson Daggers or whatever, but they still did it. And for them, it was way harder. And back then, only the fittest will survive, you know, because if you just the thought of like, oh, maybe this is not good for me, it would cross your mind, you would probably like be forgotten like instantly. But right now you have a bigger chance to stay out there. Like everything you do, like you do something, you hashtag it, and then a lot of people will see it. You do a fan art of Star Wars, like, just go by the trends. Like, whenever I saw, like, there's a movie coming out or whatever that's kind of popular, I would do, like, a fan art or something. I think my most viewed image on DeviantArt, even though it's, like, right now I would start trying to repaint some of it because it really bothers me. It's one of the Game of Thrones, with Khaleesi.
Oh, I love that one, man. That's one of my favorite ones.
but yeah, I did it in the right time. It was for a contest. That contest allowed me to attend this workshop in Portugal, Trojan Horse. If you haven't been there, go there. It's amazing. I've been there for 3 years. This year is going to be the fourth year, and I'm going to go again. It's amazing. You can meet so many people. And yeah, like, all these things that they only get you one step closer to what you want. But the more you do it, the closer you're going to get of achieving your dream.
Nice.
So just post, talk to everyone, be nice to everyone, do tutorials. Oh, yeah, tutorials. Like, even now, I don't feel like I have anything special to say about tutorials, but I still do them because tutorials can be super helpful for someone that's starting out and they really want to get in your head and like figure out what you're doing. And sometimes, like, you look at an artist and you see like something super obvious, like using the smudge brush or whatever, and you don't get it because you just found out about it right now. And yeah, that tutorial can change someone's life, and they would recommend you, like, hey, have you seen this guy's tutorial? And they're gonna give it forward and so on. And yeah, all these things will help you like get your name out there, and you're gonna return something to the community also. That's also nice, and I feel good about this. Like, it's the only good things that I do, I think. Like, when I put up tutorials, because I give what I learned over the years back to people that are starting now. And yeah, and I'm not talking about the premium ones that I have. Just go on YouTube and it's the same thing, but it's free. And you're gonna see what I'm doing and how I'm doing it. And yeah,
okay. So I guess I don't think I've ever I think I've seen your workflow. Your workflow is very line art line arty. So I guess I'll ask for people that don't know what your workflow is, because again, that's another typical question. Like, did the question is, did your workflow change from when you first started to now? And what was your workflow then to now? Like, did you start with values and go to color, then, or now do you start with colors? It doesn't matter. You know, you could do whatever. Like, how did that work?
Well, regarding the color subject, I always thought that maybe if I want to learn color, I should only draw in color. So I never do like value. If I do a black and white image, it's gonna be black and white till the end. I never try to color. Like, I think it defeats the purpose of learning how to paint in black and white and then to try to figure out in Photoshop and using overlays and all that crap and try to color something. I think it's bullshit. If you want to learn color, just pay attention to colors and try to figure out colors. But yeah, my workflow right now, it's chaotic. It depends what I'm doing. Right now I picked up 3D and I'm implementing it in my workflow, so my whole workflow has changed. I picked up photography and I think differently about composition. And yeah, on a, if I would simplify my workflow, I would say, yeah, I create a line art, and then from the line art, I can move forward. But basically, in the line art, I usually find the pose and the design of the character that I, or whatever I'm drawing. Because line art is, I've been training so much in line art that I can establish in my head a goal on what I want to achieve in the end. So I'm doing I don't consider my line art to be super clean or anything, but when I do it, I know how it's gonna look in the end. Like, it doesn't need to be perfect. So yeah, and it's super fast line art. That's why I do it. But this being said, I know so many artists that think in shapes and silhouettes, and they can do line art. They can't wrap their heads around line art. But it's just how your brain works, and just, again, I'm doing what I like, and I feel line art is nicer. Even in your sketchbook, you're not gonna draw with a big chunk of chalk. Not chalk. You're not gonna do silhouettes. You have those copic markers with a wide blade. Yeah. But usually you draw it with lines, and you can express your idea so much faster. And yeah, from line art, I might do some masking, like some selections. I call them selections, but you actually mask stuff.
Yeah.
That's what I meant through selections. I used to do the stuff with the pen tool, blocking the silhouette of the line art, and then break everything down. And but right now, I don't give a fuck about that anymore, because that pigeonholed me into this corner where I was too afraid to change something because I did it in the line art, and then you would start rendering, and if you realize that you don't really like it, basically you end up with a shitty image and you don't change it. But right now I don't really care that much about my previous workflow. If I see something that I don't really like, I just erase it and then repaint it, because yeah, it's so much better. Once you see the mistake, it's gonna scream at you like constantly. And you can be lazy about it and not change it, and your image is gonna look like shit in the end when you post it. Or it's gonna look better. But so, you have to fight with the image, and the more you fight, the better it's gonna get.
So I guess, yeah, I guess it depends on the artist and stuff.
Banana.
Banana.
Did I drop? Did you drop?
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Banana.
Yeah, I can hear
you. I caught it. I was like, banana. Oh! Am I good now?
Yeah, I think so. My Skype quality signal is a bit yellow.
Uh-oh. Whoopsie daisy.
Yeah, but you can hear me well?
Yeah, I can hear you. You're good. You're good.
Okay.
Somebody said stream went down. What the hell? Okay. I think it's back up. There's somebody I think that knows you that's writing a creative default, I think. I don't know. I think they might know you, but it sounds like they're, I don't know. But anyway, okay, so I guess the process. Huh?
I just said hello to the guy that knows me. I don't know who it is because I don't have the thing open.
So process.
It's really bad here. And
process is individual is what you're saying. It's really at the end of the day, like what the individual person is. And that's common sense. But the reason why, you know, a lot of these questions come just like, what kind of computer do you use and blah, 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 you know, what kind of brushes do you use is because they, I guess in a lot of ways they want to know, kind of a process to sort of get comfortable with, but the end game is not getting too comfortable because eventually.
I think it's banana again.
Uh-oh.
Because.
And I think a lot of it, at the end of the day, it ends up being like, it's looked down upon like, oh, that's a dumb question. But for the people starting out, it's kind of like, okay, this person does this or does that. So in a lot of ways, it's a dumb question, but it is a smart question because they want to have something to shoot for. So I guess, you know what I'm saying? So that's kind of why I like asking some questions like that. Obviously, I'm not going to ask you, like, what kind of brushes do you use or anything like that. That's kind of dumb. But yeah, I think process is really cool because I know it develops, you know, over time. Like maybe you start out with line art now, and then next thing you know, you're doing just silhouettes, etc. So
yeah, but that's the thing. No one will arrest you if you change your process. If you feel that you can do something better in another way, and you want to take that road, take it.
Exactly. So. I guess
what you want to achieve in the end, the result. In the end, the result matters. Like, if you don't care that you cut out 10 photos and you put them and you didn't even paint it over them and you present that as a final illustration and you go risking out like copyright infringements and you still don't care. But if that's what you want, do that. It's like no one will stop you.
Isn't that what everybody does nowadays? I'm kidding.
No.
I'm kidding.
No, I'm not trying to make fun of the guys that use photos. Like, even at work, I started working 4 months ago in studio, and there are jobs that I can't do without photos. And I mean, the deadline is so short that I have to.
You have to, yeah.
The client doesn't give a shit if it's painted or if it's a photo of a gun.
Yeah.
They really literally don't give a shit, and then like give the client what the client wants and then go home and paint for yourself and enjoy.
Yep. So yeah, that's my thing. I think I don't know. I guess it's a deep talk. I don't want to hit on that too much, but I guess we'll go to the next question, which was being critical on yourself. I think from the looks of it, you're pretty critical on yourself. So, like, are you or are you not? I'm just assuming.
As I should be, probably. Yeah. I don't think I'm critical with my work. I'm like that sculptor that fell in love with his sculpture. I do a shitty thing and then I kind of see the mistake and then I'm so lazy to change it. But in the end, if you grow the balls and change the things that you see that they're wrong, it's gonna look better. But yeah, man, like I'm so lazy sometimes.
So you don't think you're critical enough with yourself?
Yeah. Probably I would be so much further away if I would be more critical.
Ah, that's interesting. Because I figured you would be.
This is another thing. Like, I'm not saying that I'm modest now, but a lot of artists, like, think of themselves like super modest, and maybe I'm critical, maybe you see me as critical, and maybe I'm critical, but I don't think I'm hard enough with myself. Like, I think I could do better, and sometimes I have times where I really focus on being hardcore, and I do that, But slowly and slowly, I go back into my natural lazy state where I'm just fearing everything. And I don't know, just like my advice is like, whenever you feel that you're doing something right, don't stop until you fucking fall asleep. Because you don't know when you're going to get in that zone again. You know, that art zone where I was telling you that you're one with the drawing and it feels like you're not even drawing anymore.
The zone.
This being said, being in that zone can make you go deeper in the mistake that you're doing because you don't have fresh eyes on the painting. So everything that I'm saying can be good or bad right now. Just, I recommend to people that listen to this stuff and think that I'm some sort of authority in art. I'm not. It's like, I just go and do stuff and maybe later I'm going to realize it's wrong and I'm going to try to change it. So do like that yourselves. Like, if I tell you not to use the smudge brush, go out there and use the smudge brush and realize why you shouldn't use the smudge brush. And by the way, right now I'm not saying that it's bad to use the smudge brush. I use it all the time. But have a critical mind. Stop eating bullshit from other people.
Yep. Makes sense. So okay, so now we talked about being critical, and so like during your learning, when you were learning, your learning phase, how did you stay positive? Like, what was your thing? What did you do? There's people that like took walks, etc. And this is because a lot of the guys here that are watching this are going through that.
For me, it's all about that. That's the thing. I've changed in the past year or years.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning, I was doing it because that moment when you post your artwork online and you see the reaction of the people,
uh-huh,
it feels nice to know that you're appreciated, that you're doing the right thing. But slowly that changed. Like, it kind of gave me an ego, and a lot of people think that I don't have an ego, but I'm struggling with my other self that wants the likes, you know? And instead of focusing on what's important, I focus on something stupid, like the likes and the shares and the whatever. I don't know, someone commented on my order, oh my god, I'm so good now. Fuck no, that only makes your ego bigger and bigger. There are some people that are super humble and they can work with that and they realize, but I think I have an addictive or addicted personality. That's why I draw a lot, because once I do something and I really enjoy it, I kind of become addicted to it. Same with the guitar, same with everything that I like. I just do it because it's addictive. And that's a big problem with the stuff that's kind of bad for your, like, health or career. Like, I still do things that I probably shouldn't do, but they give me that content feeling for a few moments. And I don't know. Do you get what I mean? Or?
Yeah. I know exactly what you mean. So you said you, like, you have an addictive personality. Like, I'm wondering if you're like me, you listen to the same song over and over and over and over and over and over.
Yeah, and if you change a lot. Well, if I go to a restaurant and I have the first time a pizza, then they say it's a good pizza.
That's the same thing, you keep eating.
At that restaurant. I'm not trying another restaurant or another pizza unless it's bad.
Exactly, yes. That's exactly, yes.
It's like, if it's not broken, don't fix it, but this is good and bad in the same time. I know that I can get that kind of result with that thing, but after a while you're going to feel stuck and just... I think human beings try always to find something else. Otherwise, why would they fucking try to build planes and fucking fly into space, go to Mars? It's like, they're just bored of this planet and they want something else. Planet Earth for astronauts is like the same restaurant, and they want to go across the street to eat at, I don't know who, at the sushi bar, and that Mars is the sushi bar, right?
Yeah, that makes sense, dude. That makes sense. I was reading some of the chat. They were,
there were, oh, yeah, if there are any questions that they want me to answer, I don't know. I'm here for you guys. Like, whatever you want. So you want money, I'm going to give me your PayPal. I'm going to send you love.
It says
I don't have money. Don't give me your PayPal.
Oh, that's weird.
If I want, I can give you my PayPal. You can send me some money.
So I guess we'll go with the last question one of the last questions that I had.
All right.
Let's see. We'll go with a typical, what was the best piece of advice you were ever given? Regarding art, obviously.
I don't know. It's something that I said earlier, but it's not related to art. It's related to everything. Always try to think for yourself. Yeah, listen to an interview, read a book about like motivation and stuff. Take it all in and only use it if it fits you. And I mean, we all kind of have these personalities, and you kind of know if you're doing something that's good or bad. And probably you should gravitate toward good, because that advances the humankind. And yeah, the thing is that listen to those things, but if you think they're bullshit and you're gonna do more evil with them, just stop doing them and try to find something else. I don't know. There's no advice that could change your life today.
You don't think so? It's all
about you. Just enjoy yourself, be critical, steal from a lot of artists, not only from one. I'm trying not to give all the advice that you could use. Write things down, try to draw with line art if you're drawing only in silhouette, try to draw with silhouettes if you're only drawing with line art, try to draw in values if you're only drawing in colors. Maybe you're going to notice that your values are fucked up because you don't really understand colors and values properly. And so, like, always think as yourself as being stupid and try to imagine what you need to do to become smart.
That makes sense. That makes sense.
Other than that, I don't know, like, and just draw a lot. It's, I read somewhere that the brain is like a field of grass, like tall grass. And let's say you want to get from this point A to point B. The first trip from point A to point B might take a while because you have to put down all that grass. You might get lost because there's no clear path. But as the more you do that path, eventually probably you're going to build a highway. You're going to go there with a car, so you're gonna be like so much faster from point A to point B, right? So the more you do something, the brain is gonna get better at that. And it's there's the thing that if you're slacking, your brain is gonna become better at slacking. It's gonna find new ways to slack off. Like, if you don't feed your brain with good information, your brain is gonna build that highway that goes towards the laziness, right? So use this to your own advantage. Build a schedule, follow it, and I don't know, just do it.
That makes sense. I like that metaphor, dude, the tall grass. Like, I picture myself, like, chopping up grass as I'm walking towards, like, this house, and I'm like...
Machete.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense, dude. Like, wow. And then you start seeing things clear, you see the pathway, and you go and do it. That makes beautiful sense, actually.
And when you have that pathway, you can expand into other pathways. That's the thing. Don't stick to drawing. Pick up 3D. You have so many resources today. It's like so hard not to do something else. I mean, if you say that you're bored, I'm sorry, but you're dumb. you can't be bored today. You're not allowed to be bored.
Yep.
You're only bored if you just, I don't know, scroll on Facebook for like 20 minutes. Yeah, it kind of gets boring. Like, that scroll wheel, like, it's not clicking anymore. You know when you have a new mouse and it kind of clicks when you scroll? There are guys that have their mouse and kind of you spin it once and it runs like a wheel forever.
That makes sense, dude. So, I guess we'll start taking the last few questions of people that sure. that they had. One of them was it says, what would you recommend for artists that spend a lot of time drawing 10 to 11 hours a day for years, I guess, but can't start drawing anything from imagination, only studies?
Well, you have to develop an exercise for imagination. That's how I started drawing armor. I would study 7 hours armor, and then for 1 hour I draw armor from imagination, where I would apply things that I learned.
So yeah, pretty simple.
Drawing studies and you never apply. It's that fear. I know the fear. I still have it. I told you, it's like it never goes away. And you're only a fool if you're thinking that one day you're gonna be like fucking Kim Jong Gi. And even Kim Jong Gi, I'm sure he fears things.
Yeah.
But he drew so much that right now for us it seems that he's just doing it. He doesn't care anymore. But I bet he filled like probably a big room filled of paper. There's like metric cubes of of pieces of paper with drawings on them. So that's what you need to do.
So
you
yeah,
need to build up an exercise like, and that's the exercise like that I used. I drew 7 hour studies and then I would for an hour. I said to myself, okay, imagination time. And it doesn't matter if the drawing sucks. Just keep on doing it every day. Force yourself to draw from imagination. It's not going to happen. Point A is you being here and trying to draw something. Point B is the imagination drawing. First day, going through the field is going to suck. You're not going to be able to do a big thing, probably. But, yeah, keep on doing it and that the path from A to B is going to become so much easier to walk on.
Yeah, for me, it was a little different because coming into this community, I didn't know, like, when I was growing up, I grew up with comic books and stuff like that. And I got some really bad advice from some of my favorite artists that prided themselves that would say using reference or doing using references like for cheats or like it should all be from your imagination, and I was like
I think artists before
go ahead
even I like today when people ask me is this from imagination or reference, and most of the times I'm inclined to say it's from imagination, but sometimes I open a reference without even realizing, and it's on the other monitor. I browse something and I look at it, and it's still reference, right?
Yeah.
But in my head, like, it sounds so much better to say that you did it from imagination, but, well, my point was that back in the day, probably, like, there was this mentality among artists not to share stuff. And they were like kind of scared because, yeah, you know how to do something, and I don't know, maybe you were fearing that, oh my God, I work so much on my own. They had no internet, they had anything, and probably they were like a bit suspicious of anyone asking this question. So they and they would sound badass. Like even have you seen the Painting with Fire documentary with Frank Frazetta?
No, I haven't seen that yet. I heard it's good though.
Yeah, but he sounds like one of those asshole artists. Sorry, like, when everything I touch turned into a fucking painting. Like,
oh my God.
I'm sure you said. He shows you a full wardrobe full of cameras. What were those cameras for? Einstein is like, they're not there just because he collected cameras. He took a lot of reference pictures.
Anatomy. Yeah. And I mean, I feel the same way about photo bashing. Like, the thing is if you're going to photo bash, like, just say you're photo bashing. And I guess it's the same way you feel about Frank Frazetta. Like, if you're using reference, say you're using reference. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, but back in the day also, that was a new thing that pumped up their ego, and they would have been seen by the other average Joes in the world, like, oh my God, this is a true artist, like, whatever. Because if you would pick Frank Frazetta and, I don't know, give me another painter that's awesome in fantasy, And let's say Frank Frazetta says that he's not using reference, and the other guy, let's say Leyendecker, says that he uses reference, you're going to kind of think that Frazetta has something else. Like,
yeah.
He's a bit better than Leyendecker, you know?
Yeah.
Because you're going to think, okay, this guy paints this, like this from imagination. This guy is dependent on reference. This guy is better. This is, I think it's the evolution, the genetics, it's written in our DNA. We always look for the best genes and stuff. And even though, like, some animals on this planet deceive, like the cuckoo bird. Is it the cuckoo bird? Where, like, they put their eggs in this other bird's nest, and this is them. Like, they say, okay, I made the egg, I make babies. But how they did it? Probably, if they were real people, they wouldn't admit that they put the egg in another bird's nest and they got their babies, right? They would say, oh, I made my own nest and I made this tiny little bird.
So you're saying we're like we're like natural deceivers, like we're natural, we just want to...
Yes, some people are deceivers, some people are honest, some people want to help, some people want to confuse you. Because they think if you're going to be as smart as them, you're going to surpass them. There are different psychologies that are, like, and I'm not, I gave you the example with the birds, and it's the same. We're just, like, some typical psychologies, and some people are like that, just like that. They just want to deceive you so they can be ahead of you. Or they want to seem bigger than they are.
Yeah. Yeah, that's...
I'm not throwing shit on Frank Frazetta. Like, he has some amazing things, but I think he was lying about the reference.
No, I'm the same way, dude. Like, I'll watch stuff and I'll, like, nitpick, like, wait a minute. But, no, yeah, Frank Frazetta still, whether he used reference or not, you know, like, it would have been nice if he did admit that he did. Can you hear me?
Hello? It's cutting out now.
Uh-oh.
I've got red message.
Uh-oh.
Now it's yellow. Quick, tell me the question.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay. No, but I was saying, it's I guess, the honesty in the artist. But, you know, at the end of the day right now, it's like, I don't think anybody cares anymore. At this point, it's like... Everybody's just
there
doing...
are still people that care, and there are people that are getting deceived, like beginners. It's like, probably this is another thing why big artists lie, because this is a way to make money out of beginners.
Exactly.
And they sell you all this, okay, in 5 minutes, like, follow my tutorial and you're going to be amazing. And I'm ashamed to admit, but I did that too. I posted, like, my PlayStation control tutorial, and I said... learn how to paint like this in 5 hours. And that... I just wanted to make a marketing strategy, like, you know, like... But in the end, like, I got messages that really upset people. So probably I should change that cover, like... You're not gonna learn how to paint like that in 5 hours, but... In that tutorial, I shared every fucking piece of information that I have. So you can paint like that in 5 hours.
You're just selling it, man. You were just selling it.
Yeah, but yeah, you're probably not gonna be able to pick up on every piece of information that I gave in there, and you're gonna be angry at me, and I'm apologizing if I made any of you angry.
Nah.
But.
I think it makes sense, dude. Obviously, if you think you're gonna learn how to do this crazy stuff in 5 hours, like, okay, you're somewhere else. I think you can learn your techniques and the way you're thinking in 5 hours, which is, I think, very important. But that's kind of like the buyers, you know. It should be like a disclaimer, like, okay, guys, you know, whatever. But it makes sense. Actually, I think I got one of your Gumroads, which was the ambient occlusion one. Are you still doing that, like the ambient occlusion thing?
Depends on the project. Like, I learn all these tools to use them whenever they give me an advantage to do something faster. So right now I haven't been using it in quite a while.
That's kind of, I mean, the ambient.
If I want something super sharp and crispy,
yeah,
I would use it. But at work, I've been doing lately concept art stuff. And this is not like in the past 2 or 3 years, I've been doing only illustration work with for card companies and stuff. And at work now, I'm doing more concept art stuff. And it's nice, like it feels like a fresh bag of air. I was kind of choking in that all that card shit. I kind of hate it now.
So you like doing concept art now, you said?
Yeah, and for concept art, it's like the idea matters the most. And right now, I'm retraining my brain for design stuff. And I'm not just trying to make a pretty picture. I'm trying to find sense in it. And there are all other principles that I was kind of aware of them, but I wasn't really tackling them. So now I'm changing my mentality. Again, I picked up on 3D, and that modeling things in 3D kind of makes you understand how to draw things in 3D, like how to add details, or using those tools like beveling stuff or insetting, extruding and all that crap. Merging two objects like Boolean operations, they give you ideas for drawing in 2D, and you can go back and forth, and it's really amazing. But yeah, what was the question again? I'm so sorry. My mind is weird.
Yeah, I feel the same way, dude. I think we both got lost. It's fine. It works.
You asked me about the ambient occlusion. I don't use it that much today, but
that was
if I'm gonna get an illustration where I have to do, probably I use it a lot on those League of Legends fan arts.
Yeah,
I think only one of them wasn't done with ambient occlusion, the RE one, the one with nine tails.
Yeah,
it was just like painting, but the other ones I explored that theme, and the last image that I did was the Jinx one, and I think that was the most successful one.
Yeah, I was looking at that earlier.
I built up. See, again, like, when I see a technique online, I try to find a tutorial. And if I can't find it, I build a tutorial in my head. And for those first two images or three images that I did, I didn't really understand the technique. But as doing the mistakes, made me realize, okay, this is not the way to do it. So I was forced to find another way. And eventually, I got from point A to point B, again, that field of grass. But, yeah, you have to tackle the problems. They're not going to be fixed by themselves. And don't always believe, like, yeah, a tutorial can help you. I learned a lot from tutorials, but sometimes I buy a tutorial because I think there's something magic in it. But in the end, the guy just paints from beginning until the end, and they don't use any special technique or anything. And I realized, okay, I knew this. It was just in my head that I don't know this.
It makes sense.
So,
it makes sense. I remember when that ambient occlusion thing happened. I think it was that artist Giyu Kazi that.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
I saw it like, oh my god. I still can't paint like him. And that's the thing, like, I can't copy him because he obviously does some things different. And I don't really understand what.
Yeah.
But I found my own way of doing ambient occlusion stuff. It's similar to him, but it's a bit different.
Yeah, I don't know
if it's worse or whatever, but
Me and Chris Bjors, I know, you know who Chris Bjors is, right?
Yeah,
we were talking about it, like, it's the same thing. Like, we dissected the shit out of it for a long time, and then you came up with your thing, and we were like, yeah, so it was kind of an interesting take, I guess, on things, but
yeah,
it was cool. So on to the next question from another Alex Denalia. he says, or she says, I don't know if it's a he or she, do you think the art industry will grow in Romania? We're just talking about your Romanian. What were your main struggles that you had getting in the industry in Romania?
Don't think at Romania. You have the internet, you're global now. It's the whole internet has brought us all together. You're not living in Romania anymore. You're living on the internet. And you don't need to. Yeah, it's growing in Romania. If you want me to answer your question, there are so many studios that open up right now. There are like smaller studios and there are big established studios like Ubisoft and Gameloft. I think there are two or three Gamelofts. I know there's one in Cluj, one in Bucharest. I know there's two Ubisofts. I think there was one EA. I don't know if it's still there. There was City Interactive. There are a lot of studios, but the thing is, once you get in the studio, it's all about you if you're gonna evolve or not. Because the studio, you're gonna be forced to draw some things that you don't really like, and that might get in your learning process, or you might get, okay, I'm drawing for 8 hours. It still counts as drawing, and you're not gonna push forward anymore. When I got my first studio job, I was assigning every day. I was waking up before my actual work started. I was waking up at 6 and do 2 hours. I think I was doing back in the day, I was doing the live stream in the morning, and then I would go to work. I would draw whatever the fuck they wanted me to draw. And after work, I would draw again for myself. I would do commissions or whatever. Because just this going and having a job is not everything. You can be left behind. Like, you need to push forward. Don't go for a studio job just because it's cool to have a job. You can have a job even if you don't go to a studio. You can be a freelancer. And that's amazing. But this being said, I think, yeah, everywhere the studios are, like, the industry grows and there are going to be more and more jobs.
Yeah, that's what I tell people. Like, people think that art is still, like, the same way. Like, oh, are you based out of New Jersey? It's like, dude, you can work anywhere you pretty much want. You're, like you said, you're on the internet. You can do whatever you want. So, yeah, I guess it makes sense.
For also with the studio, if you get a job in a studio, if you don't live close to the studio, you waste time every day going to the studio. When I was working for Gameloft, I was wasting 2 hours every day. It was 1 way to go, 1 hour to go, and 1 hour to go back.
Fuck.
From the studio. And those are 2 hours that you can invest in something. So right now, I live 4 minutes away by foot to my work, because I would, even though the rent is a bit higher in this area, but I don't think of those money. Like, I would rather pay more money and live closer.
Exactly.
So I can use that time to my advantage. With those 2 hours, if I would take freelance, I don't do freelance anymore at all. So especially so I can work on my stuff. But with those 2 hours, I can get super fast, like, and recover those money, like, maybe multiplied by 10 or 100. I don't know. Analyze your problems. I know everyone's life is different. You all have your problems, your advantages, and just put everything and do the math and adapt. That's what I'm trying to do. It's not always working, but doing the mistakes will help you get, like, closer to the solution.
That makes sense. That's interesting, dude. I like the way you think, though. It's cool to know that you're kind of like-minded. It's pretty cool. I guess onto the last question that we have. One of the last questions. So we're a little bit laggy, so I lost some of the stuff that we had because people started asking stuff, and then we restarted. So this is the last question. I mean, we're at an hour and a half right now, so it's not too bad. It's pretty good. from Miss Play. She said, do you have any advice for drawing, composing environments for people who draw characters mostly? How do you put a nice background for characters?
You can try to cheat. I mean, not the cheaty way, but if you don't really care about environments, and you know in your heart that you will never care about environments.
That's me. Yep.
Probably just slap a photo and blur it and or change. But be careful if it's personal work or even if it's client work. Be careful what photo you use. Or try to change the background a bit, change the windows in the building. I don't know why. But still, like, avoiding this kind of stuff. I don't like environments either, but I still try to do some things about it, because that's how you become, like, closer to your dream and to become a master of painting, to become that number one guy that I was talking about earlier. That doesn't exist. But yeah, like, the more you know, the better you're gonna get. It's like, it doesn't hurt to know perspective. It doesn't hurt to be able to draw an environment for a character. And it can be fun. You shouldn't see it as a problem. Just see it as a new opportunity for yourself to learn something new.
Nice.
And who knows, you might like environments more than characters. Because an environment is like a character. Of course, in the beginning, it might seem like, okay, I have to add the background, so I'm going to add the default stuff. But it's the same with environments as it is with the characters. The more you think about what's this environment, what can I add in here, the more you're going to start, like, treating that environment as a character. You're going to add elements that support the story of the environment and also the character. And a good environment can make your character even stronger. Or you can use, for example, contrast. For example, your character is super rich, but you put him in a shitty environment, and what that says a lot about your character. Maybe he's a good guy going in that shitty environment to help people, or maybe he's a poor guy dressed up as a rich man that's trying to fool out other rich people to get some more money. I don't know. See, they support each other. But this being said, I would say that my advice would be just grow some balls and draw some environments.
Yeah, I guess don't be afraid to explore. I did environments for a while just to learn, like, perspective and stuff like that. I gotta say, like, it's a lot of fun because it's more of world building than character stuff. So it is fun. But I think my love is in characters, and I think maybe, like, it's obvious, like, you have the characters and the environment, so it depends, I guess, on the type of person you are. So, but yeah, like you were saying, don't be scared. Eventually, like me, I want to maybe next year concentrate on environments, like, just completely. So it depends, and I think that's a thing that people are scared of. Like, you're on a timeline, and it's like, dude, just take your time, learn what you got to do, learn characters, and then later on, you know, tackle on the environments. Like, there's no pressure. Nobody has a gun to your head. Like, right now, learn what you want, learn what you love, and then eventually you'll be good enough to where you're like, okay, now I can tackle environments. Now I can do that. So one step at a time is what I think.
Starting out, I also get tired of drawing the same thing over and over again. So that's why I would start drawing vehicles and stuff. That's how I learned perspective, because I was bored of anatomy. I was drawing over and over the same arms and shit from loonies and from bums. And after one point, it's like, what's the point of this? I don't understand anything anyways. So you start, and you still want to draw something, right? And that's why I started drawing vehicles. I watched Scott Robertson's tutorials on how to draw vehicles in perspective. And in the beginning, I didn't understand anything, but it made more sense than the anatomy. Like, perspective is, that's the fun part about perspective. And it's precise. And you can always count on a cube of being a cube. It's like, it's not like a muscle that can have different shapes, and it's confusing. There are a million of them on the bone, and you don't even know what you're looking at. Even with anatomy, it's like, I studied a lot of anatomy from books. That helped me. I'm not saying it didn't help me, but only when I started doing gestures and trying to build muscle memory, really, like when I'm doing gestures, what I'm trying to do is, one, to see what the, I call this, called the, it's called the cinematics of the movement of the body. Like, what can an arm do? What it happens when it's going to be raised up or whatever. Like, that's when I realized how many poses can I draw, like, and there's infinite possibilities. Just drawing from books, you can learn the shape of the muscles, but you will always draw that default standing guy, like full frontal view, and of course that guy looks boring. Everyone hates him. They want to draw like super dynamic perspective, like Marco Giorgio. Like, I don't know if you saw the covers that he did for
Marco. Oh yeah, I did. Yeah, yeah.
Floating guys and like fighting, and that's the cool shit, right? You want to do that, but the drawing from books won't help you really achieve that. You have to study some real life and combine these two different exercises into one. Because yeah, you draw like let's say from a picture of a real person, you draw the pose, maybe you don't understand the anatomy, but doing those studies from the books kind of give you an idea. Okay, maybe here's the bicep, here's the tricep, and whatever the name of the other muscles.
So that's the other question that she was asking. What books did you look at and references for like learning? Is there anything specific that you'd recommend?
For me at least, I like books. I'm going to recommend a few. I really like Framed Ink.
Framed Ink is good, yeah.
And yeah, all the anatomy books are cool. Anatomy for Sculptors is an amazing book.
That's,
you can find
that's on the Pinterest blue one. That's the blue one, right? Yeah.
Sorry?
The Anatomy for Sculptors, that's the blue one, the blue book, isn't it? I think.
Yeah, it's like they separate the muscles with different colors.
Yeah.
And it's based, they do it over a photo, and it's easier to understand actually than those Loomis books, at least for me. But I would recommend just watching tutorials, video, like when you see people how they draw, it's a different thing. I'm not saying it, reading tutorials or it's bad, but we're like monkeys. We monkey see, monkey do, right?
Yeah.
When you see someone doing something, it's like you're drawing with them in the same time. When you look at the final drawing, you can't imagine that guy drawing it, or you don't know where he started this from. Or
so that makes sense.
Yeah, the video tutorials might give you a better advantage to learning.
That makes sense. So. Okay, so that makes sense. Have you ever checked out Color and Light? That's a pretty good book, too. I don't know.
Yeah. I have that one, too.
That's a really good
book. But again, like, it's a hard-to-digest book for me because it has a lot of information, but you have to read a lot.
Yeah.
Also, A La Prima by, I don't remember his name.
I think I know which one you're talking about. I haven't seen that. I haven't read that.
Richard Schmidt, I think.
Is it?
Yeah.
I'll check it out.
I think so.
So good stuff, good references, good advice. I think what I'll start doing with every interview that we do, I think there's one thing that pings in my head, and because I know I'm interviewing you, but at the same time I'm looking at this as an artist, and I think the biggest thing I got out of this was that metaphor of the grass. I loved it, and I think like now I'm looking at that, like I keep imagining that in my head, like just this guy chopping shit down, and the more you do it, the more you clear the path, the more you can get there. And that's like a great way of thinking of things is if you're studying mindlessly, you're just chopping away like random grass, and you're never gonna find a solid path. Like,
yeah, eventually you can stumble upon the solution. That's true, but
yeah. So it was interesting that's I think what I got the most out of it. Everything else is kind of, I think, for the most part, like what you learn is the basics. You know, work your ass off, you're gonna get better, and etc. But
that, sorry for interrupting you. If you really like to be motivated today, go and listen to Vitaly Bulgarov's interview on the Collective podcast. Ashtorp.
Which one?
Vitaly Bulgarov. He's a 3D guy. He will blow your mind.
Okay.
He's my new, like, idol.
He's your new inspiration.
Number one. See, right now I don't even have a 2D guy anymore at the top. It's a 3D guy.
That's interesting.
But that guy is something else.
That's good stuff. What was his name again?
Vitaly Bulgarov.
Vitaly, okay.
I'm going to type it in here and you can type it in the chat.
Okay, I'll share it. I'll put it up there.
It was 10 days and 10 mechs.
Holy shit. So, yeah. Oh, by the way, I guess I'll plug Ash. Vitaly.
The single L, I think.
Vitaly Bulgarov. Okay, sweet. I'll add that on there. I'll plug Ash's thing in here. Ash does some really cool interviews as well. Really cool guy too. So check his it's more of a podcast thing, right? He does like a podcast. So
yeah
check out his stuff.
Yeah, this was my favorite. I didn't listen to a lot of them, but this was enough for me. When I heard this thing, it was super motivating. And then again, if you I like the Rocky Balboa movies.
Yes.
I have all the collection. I saw recently Creed also.
I haven't seen it yet, dude. I'm like dying to see it because I'm waiting to get it on because I couldn't go watch it at the movies, so I'm gonna get it on like Blu-ray or some shit and watch
it. That's a cool movie.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan. I'm a huge fan of Rocky, dude. Huge fan.
What I wanted actually to mention is like I'm all like into this muscle guy. So they're a big inspiration. So I really like Arnold, and he has a book called Total Recall, Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Uh-huh.
And he talks about his life, and it's also super inspirational.
Nice. That's good stuff. So the Rocky movies, Arnold.
Machines and super efficient at what you do. Just like listen to these two guys and become the next like Terminator of art.
That's awesome, dude. That's good stuff. So that's inspirational, guys, for you guys. I think inspiration, whatever it is you're doing, like it's the same thing. It's the same concept. As long as you love what you're doing, just keep doing it and getting better at it and feeding your brain with information. So
if you feel like it's stressing you too much, just do something else. I'm sure most of you guys have different hobbies too, not just drawing. So
yeah. Oh, guitar. Actually, I was gonna ask you, what type of music do you play?
Well, I it's mainly rock music, but I don't really care. Like it's the same with drawing. I just try to enjoy myself.
You mix it up. So like what kind of rock?
I only know around 10 songs. How to play them. But
what do you play? Electric.
I play game Rocksmith, and that's a nice thing, like, because you can learn like real songs and accurate songs, and you have a practicing thing in it. It's really cool.
So what do you play, like electric or acoustic or?
Electric.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I play guitar too.
I have three guitars, and here I have one.
Yep, I got three too. I got a Fender Strat electric, and then I got a Fender.
I have a people for a Fender. That was my first guitar.
And I got an acoustic electric Fender, and then I got like a cheap little Yamaha acoustic. So yeah, I play a bit too. I love it. It's fun. But good stuff, man. Good information. Thanks for doing this, guys. If you by some chance in hell don't know who Alex is, just Facebook him. Like this guy is, I know he's humble, but he is fucking amazing. Like his work ethic is crazy. Check him out. Check out his Gumroads too. I know he said that you can't learn much from 5 hours, but trust me, you can learn from watching somebody do something. So
go on YouTube first before buying any of my stuff. And if you're gonna learn something from those, usually the YouTube ones don't have audio, but there are a few with audio.
Yeah. So yeah, do that. Definitely check out his Gumroad though. That's for me. I learned a lot from watching some of his stuff, which was a lot of fun. So yeah, man, thanks for coming and thanks for being a part of this. Hopefully, you know, like someday you can look back and be like, "Oh, I was a part of that crazy shit." So we know when we release the book, I'll get a hold of you and let you know what the whole thing is, and I'll make sure I ask you what we put on there and stuff like that. So thanks, man. Thanks for helping out.
I want to take the time to also thank everyone that took time over there, probably busy Saturday, to be here. Thank you very much. I'm really humbled and honored to be here, and hopefully I said some things that make you think in a different way or a better way. I don't know. If not, I'm sorry.
No, man, you definitely gave us some good feedback. So thanks, dude. Hopefully again.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to see the entries from the challenge. And remember, even like if I choose my favorites, that doesn't mean that they're the best ones. It's like, I don't know. This is the shitty part about the challenges. You have to pick up three.
Yeah. Or four. How
many.
Four.
Exactly.
Yeah. But
just enter in the challenge if you like, and I'm sure you're going to learn something, even if you're not going to win. Like, most of the challenges that I entered, I didn't win anything. But it was fun, and yeah, it's like you're in a battlefield, and you're with all your friends, and you compete with them. And sometimes you win, sometimes they win, but it's all a good experience. So hopefully, yeah, I'm going to see a bunch of you in the challenge, and
most definitely, yep. Dude. I think from now to the end of the year, we're going to see some big changes in people. Like, we already are, and this year is going to be like full throttle. So hopefully next year I'll get a hold of you and maybe we can do another one or the following, whatever, whenever you're free. So it'll be fun to have you and keep you on here, dude, because it's like I said, I think a lot of people look up to you. I look up to you. So there's a lot of good stuff that we can do with some of my favorite. I'll say my favorite artists, because I ask the people that I like, that I look up to do these things. So thanks again, guys. Thanks for coming. Thanks, Alex.
Thank you.
Next month we're having.
Have a nice day, guys.
Yep. Next month, real quick. Next month we're having Betty Yang. Judging, following Dave Wilkins, and then followed by it's either going to be Suzanne Haumei or Coral Kaufman. We're arranging a Coral Kaufman interview here soon. He's super awesome. Alex, I know you know who Coral is, so it's going to be really cool to interview. He's from my hometown, so it'll be a down to earth, just like us talking shit. We'll probably get wasted.
Speaking of the likes, like, I remember when Coral gave me my first like. It was on that first Crimson Dagger challenge that I won.
Really?
I don't know if I won, actually, but he gave me a like, and I was like, fuck yeah, Coral gave me a laugh.
You freaked out. Yeah. I'm the same way. I'm still the same way. Like, I get likes from people. I'm like, oh my god, Kim Jong-ji. Like, you know, so it happens. I mean, that's the selfish thing is I mean, we all look up to each other.
It's like you catch the, like, you know, when playing the Pokemon game, there's that fucking teleporting guy. It's like an electric Pokemon. Oh my god, I hated that guy, like, so hard. But yeah, it appears once in a while and gets so happy when you see him.
I love it though. I love that idea though. I think that's what keeps people humble. I don't think I'll ever get to a point where I'm like, oh, I'm better than everybody else. You know, that's the awesome part about like art is you will always have inspirations, and that's awesome. You know, like, so. Yeah, keep at it, guys. Keep your head, you know, in the game. Stay positive. Don't get crazy. Like, I don't know. I don't get to talk to everybody that often, but like Alex was saying, you know, just do what you love is what he was trying to say. I think that's kind of what it boils down to, is do what you love and don't worry about money. Don't worry about all that other bullshit. Like, obviously, if you need money, then get a job and keep getting better at art and you know. But yeah, that's all I have, Alex. Any last words before we cut off?
I don't know. Alex. I like beer.
Alex is like, I'm hungry. I'm about to order a fucking pizza right now. Yeah.
I need something right now, too.
Yeah, I'm about to order pizza as soon as we hang up.
I'm going to have a gathering with some guys from work. We're going to drink and draw.
Nice.
Probably drink more than draw, actually.
Nice. All right, man. Well, thanks again. And we'll see you soon, hopefully. All right.
See you, everyone.
All right, guys. Later. See you. Thanks for coming. I'm going to cut the stream. Later.